Are you curious why fertility doctors recommend intramuscular progesterone shots for some frozen embryo transfer cycles? It's not that they're trying to torture you with those long needles. There is evidence that supports that intramuscular progesterone improves live birth rates and decreases miscarriage rates in some frozen embryo transfer cycles. And today we're going to learn all about it. I'm Dr. Lora Shahine, a double board certified OBGYN and reproductive endocrinologist helping people with IVF and building families for over 20 years. I am so glad that you're here today to learn more. I love teaching. If you are new to this channel, welcome. Be sure and subscribe so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And if you are coming back, welcome back. I am so glad you're here for learning. There's two other ways to learn and stay in touch. You can sign up for my weekly newsletter, link in the description below. Learn all about fertility in the news, educational content, and recommendations. The other way is my weekly Brave and Curious podcast. You can listen anywhere you listen to podcasts. Today, we are doing a deep dive into the role of progesterone in implantation and early pregnancy, and its use in frozen embryo transfer cycles as a way to optimize outcomes. A real pain point for some of my patients is when I recommend intramuscular progesterone shots as the best progesterone delivery system for their particular situation, because they can be uncomfortable. But today we're going to review a landmark study from 2021 that really showed why intramuscular progesterone is the right choice in certain frozen embryo transfer protocols. We're going to go over five main topics. First of all, we're going to review just how important progesterone is for implantation in early pregnancy. Number two, we're going to go over why progesterone supplements are used in most fertility treatments. Number three, we're going to go over the two main protocols for frozen embryo transfer, the programmed FET protocol versus the ovulatory or natural or non-medicated frozen embryo transfer protocol. Number four, we're going to go over the different forms of progesterone supplementation. And number five, we're going to go over a landmark study that really showed which progesterone supplement is right for programmed frozen embryo transfer protocols. Topic number one, what is the role of progesterone in the menstrual cycle and getting pregnant and staying pregnant? Progesterone is the dominant hormone in the luteal phase of the menstrual cycle. Remember the menstrual cycle. The first half is the follicular phase. It starts off with menstruation, and it leads into the part of the cycle where the egg is being recruited and matured. The middle of the menstrual cycle is ovulation, and after ovulation, we lead into the luteal phase of the cycle where the dominant hormone is progesterone. This is when the embryo implants into the uterine lining and we get pregnant. And at the end of the luteal phase, if we are pregnant, we will not get a period. That progesterone will continue to support the uterine lining, continue to support that early pregnancy implantation and development. Progesterone is essential for conceiving and that early part of pregnancy. In ovulation, if someone's ovulating, the ovary is making progesterone. It comes from the follicle that released the egg and turns into a structure in the ovary called a corpus luteum cyst. That corpus luteum in the second half or luteal phase of the menstrual cycle is making progesterone. And the ovary makes progesterone until the pregnancy or the placenta starts to take over around 6 to 8 weeks of pregnancy. In assisted reproduction, when we are not ovulating, especially in a programmed frozen embryo transfer cycle, the only source of progesterone is what the fertility doctor is prescribing for you. And you need progesterone support to get the uterine lining ready for implantation and support that early pregnancy until the pregnancy or the placenta starts making its own progesterone towards the end of the first trimester. Topic number two. So why is progesterone so important for fertility treatment? Well, in a lot of fertility treatment, we need progesterone support in order to allow implantation and support that early pregnancy. If you are ovulating, let's say you do an egg retrieval and you do a fresh embryo transfer about 5 to 6 days after the egg retrieval, well, your own ovaries are going to be making some progesterone, but the disruption of doing the egg retrieval can disrupt some of the cells that make progesterone. So even in a fresh IVF embryo transfer, Even though your ovaries are going to be making some progesterone, it's standard to give the patient supporting progesterone. Now, in frozen embryo transfer cycles, there are two different types, and in both types, often progesterone is given as a way to support the early pregnancy. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about frozen embryo transfer cycles as my third topic. So the third topic, what are the different frozen embryo transfer protocols and why does it matter for progesterone? Well, there are two main types, a programmed frozen embryo transfer cycle where the patient is not ovulating and the only source of estrogen and progesterone is from prescriptions from the doctor. And the other type of frozen embryo transfer cycle, an ovulatory frozen embryo transfer cycle, the patient is ovulating. This can also be referred to as a natural frozen embryo protocol or a modified ovulatory, modified natural protocol. I like to refer to this type of protocol as ovulatory because it's really teaching the patients what's happening and what's different. Again, programmed FET protocol, no ovulation. Ovulatory FET protocol, you're ovulating. And again, some people call it a natural FET protocol. When you're ovulating in this frozen embryo transfer protocol, your ovaries are making progesterone. And the doctor's prescription is not the only source of progesterone. Now, we often will give supplemental progesterone, and we do in my clinic, Pacific Northwest Fertility in Seattle, when we're doing an ovulatory cycle, because we want to support that early pregnancy and that implantation and giving a little bit of extra progesterone. I tell my patients it's like a supplement or a vitamin. You're making your own, but we just really want to make sure that we've got enough on board. Now, I've got a whole YouTube video on the differences between programmed and ovulatory FET protocols and how patients can choose what the pros and cons are, and really good education to advocate for your care and have a great discussion with your doctor about which protocol is right for you. Now, topic number four, if we're giving progesterone to our patients, how can we prescribe it? Now, in the United States, we've got four options for giving progesterone to our patients. Option number one, oral progesterone pills. Option number two, progesterone creams that can be put on the skin. Option number three, vaginal progesterone suppositories. And number four, intramuscular progesterone shots. And progesterone is usually diluted in oil that is placed in the muscle, typically the deltoid muscle, kind of in the back. Sometimes people will put it in the upper thigh. That can hurt a little bit more, but it's got to go into the muscle and it's in oil so that it can kind of sit in the muscle and get dispersed slowly over time. Now, of these different types, the oral progesterone pills are convenient. They're easy to take, but they're less effective. They usually have less absorption and they can sometimes cause side effects. The transdermal progesterone creams, that sounds kind of nice, kind of easy to just put cream on your skin, but very little evidence and not routinely used in IVF and frozen embryo transfer protocols. Now, the vaginal progesterone suppositories are very often used. They're easily absorbed, they have less side effects, and they're kind of getting right to the uterine lining where they need to be. Now, the intramuscular progesterone shots, they are intimidating. They can be uncomfortable. A lot of patients really don't like them, but they really do a good job of getting progesterone where it needs to be, getting consistent levels kind of in the bloodstream. For the history of IVF, we've been using intramuscular progesterone to support FET protocols, fresh IVF, early pregnancies for decades. We have a lot of experience using intramuscular progesterone, but it's uncomfortable and intimidating for a lot of patients. And so we've been looking for alternatives. So that's where these alternatives come in. And very often the vaginal progesterone suppositories have been shown to do a great job in certain situations. And so the biggest question to the doctors that are taking care of the patients and the patients that are having to do these intramuscular shots, that's how I supported my frozen embryo transfer protocols, daily intramuscular shots. If they are tough, I empathize, I have been there. And so when alternatives came out, I wanted to find alternatives for my patients too, and vaginal suppositories sounded great. But the question is the vaginal suppository okay for programmed frozen embryo transfer cycles? Because remember, in a programmed frozen embryo transfer cycle, the only source of estrogen and progesterone is what the doctor is prescribing to you. You are not ovulating. So in fresh IVF, after an egg retrieval, or in an ovulatory frozen embryo transfer cycle, the ovaries are making some progesterone. And you still want to give some supplement, but it's very different. And there have been studies supporting that with fresh IVF and with ovulatory frozen embryo transfer protocols, you can use vaginal suppositories as an excellent way to supplement the progesterone that's already coming from the ovaries. The question that we have today is, what about in programmed frozen embryo transfer cycles, where what the doctor is prescribing is your only source of progesterone? Are vaginal suppositories equivalent to intramuscular progesterone? Because before you make a big change, just because you have an option and a different delivery system, you have to be sure that you still have the same live birth rates and you're not increasing miscarriage rates. And the study that came out by Divine et al. In 2021, Fertility and Sterility, answered this question for us. And that's exactly the study I want to review with you right now. The objective of this study was to answer the question, is vaginal progesterone as effective as intramuscular progesterone in programmed or medicated frozen embryo transfer cycles? The design was a randomized controlled trial in multiple different fertility centers. This is the gold standard. If you have a clinical question, the most amazing way to answer it is to do a randomized controlled trial where you have a group of patients and one group is doing one thing and the other group is doing another thing, and you see what the outcome is. The patients in the study were 1,125 patients undergoing a frozen embryo transfer cycle with unscreened blastocysts, so that they did not do pre-implantation genetic testing for aneuploidy or chromosome analysis. They had unscreened blastocysts. They were doing a programmed or a medicated frozen embryo transfer cycle, and they were separated into three groups. The first group had the traditional intramuscular progesterone support. The second group had a mix of intramuscular support and vaginal progesterone. And the third group had only vaginal progesterone. The vaginal progesterone was micronized progesterone, 200 milligrams twice a day. And the intramuscular progesterone was 50 milligrams in oil. And in the traditional daily intramuscular progesterone shots, it was every single day. In the group that had the mix of vaginal suppositories and intramuscular shots, the patients did the vaginal suppositories every single day, so twice a day. And then every third day, they would do an intramuscular shot of 50 milligrams of progesterone in oil. The results were significant, and it's really important to follow. Here is a chart showing the live birth rate per group. Live birth rate for vaginal progesterone alone was 27%. Live birth rate with a combination of vaginal and intramuscular progesterone was 46%. And live birth rate with intramuscular progesterone was 44%. So when you had intramuscular progesterone on board, whether it was every day or every third day, you had a significantly higher live birth rate compared to the vaginal progesterone alone. The difference was 17 percentage points, and that's a 63% higher live birth rate with intramuscular progesterone on board. What about miscarriage rates? Here's a chart showing those outcomes. The miscarriage rate for intramuscular progesterone only was 33%. The miscarriage rate for intramuscular plus vaginal progesterone support was 26%. And the miscarriage rate for vaginal-only progesterone was 50%. That is a significantly higher miscarriage rate in the vaginal-alone progesterone group compared to either group that had intramuscular progesterone on board. In conclusion, vaginal-only progesterone support in programmed or medicated frozen embryo protocols is not as effective as having intramuscular progesterone on board. There is a lower live birth rate with vaginal-alone progesterone. There is a higher miscarriage rate of only using vaginal progesterone. Now, another thing that came out of this study is that I'm interested in exploring more is this option of a combination. So my patients could have fewer progesterone shots and combine them with vaginal progesterone. That is a little bit new. It's hard when you have 20 years of experience, and my own successful frozen embryo transfer cycle had the daily progesterone. But I love the idea of looking into options that can decrease discomfort for my patients. So that's a lot to learn. Let's recap. Number one, we went over the role of progesterone in the luteal phase, implantation, and early pregnancy. Number two, I explained that in programmed or medicated frozen embryo transfer cycles, the only source of progesterone is what the doctor is prescribing. Number three, in this randomized controlled trial with over 1,100 patients, if you have intramuscular progesterone on board as a part of your support medication in a programmed or medicated frozen embryo protocol, you have a higher live birth rate and lower miscarriage rate compared to using vaginal suppositories alone. So we're always open to looking to new ideas, but for now, intramuscular progesterone remains the gold standard for programmed or medicated frozen embryo transfer protocols. So if you are preparing for a frozen embryo transfer cycle, talk to your doctor about which protocol and which progesterone is right for your personal situation. I hope you learned something today. Like this video if you learned something. Comment with questions that you have. Be sure and subscribe to this channel so you get my weekly videos all about reproductive health. And until next week, wishing you love, luck, and pineapples.